Welcome back. We're glad you're watching The Business Show. Now, feel free to get in touch by sending us a comment on what you think. The hashtag is right below your screen. I'm talking about the socials for The Business Show and Urban TV as well. So let us know where you're watching from and what you think about the program. Now, let's talk how to make money. And we run, it was about what, three-part series from Itunga Farm. It's a demonstration plant in Wakiso. And we need to see several things. We're talking how grass is grown for the cattle, manure is generated, and also how to handle a zero grazing plant, the benefits, plus how to run a family business, some of the advantages that come working with as husband and wife in the same business. Now, we just thought we could bring back this for you that probably missed. And let's look at how zero grazing is done on a small piece of land and how it could save you that is planning to start up a cattle rearing project some money if you picked a leaf or two from this conversation, a visit to Itunga Farm or Itunga Pastures in Wakiso District.
This is coriandra, and this is one of the best forage trees. It has got many advantages. First of all, it has got high protein, up to 22%. It can be used as hay for rabbits, for goats, for chicken, for cows. It can also be used as a windbreaker. If you have banana plantation, you can put in the side. It is also fixes nitrogen in the soil, okay? Fixes nitrogen in the soil. The bees, they like nectar from this, okay? You can use as firewood from this. We have seen that it can be as a shed, used as a shed. So many, I would actually encourage farmers to plant this, one of the best forage trees. One of the best for it. The protein content is here, is 7 to 15 tons, 20-25%, that is protein content. So this one is one of the best. You cannot do dairy, you cannot do cattle rearing, goat rearing without having this. This is what you cut.
Okay? So when you cut that, what do you do?
Now you're going to dry it.
Okay.
You can also feed after wilting the cows. The cows will eat this one. The cow will eat this one, okay? Mm. Now this is the food. But again, you can also do what? Wilt it. Wilt it and make hay, what they call leaf hay, out of this. We have already seen the advantages. So this one, I was just showing you how you... If you turn around, you're going to see the pak chong.
Now this... The big pak chong now.
Now this is the grown-up pak chong. This is the grown-up pak chong. But now this one, it has overgrown. Now this one is not good for feeding cows, rather this is for the seed. Why? The protein has shifted from these leaves and they are making the stems.
Yes.
And most of the animals, they don't eat
the stems,
they eat the thing. So now this is the grown-up super napier. This is the good stage now. This is the good stage where you should cut and feed the animals. Why? It is still young. The protein is still in these leaves, and it's 1 meter, just between 1 meter to 4 feet. This is the good stage now, where I should cut and feed the cows. The super napier is one of the best. Grows very fast, good for silage. Yeah, and it has got high protein content compared to other napier family.
Okay.
So this one for silage. Yes, this is Guatemala. It's good, it's a good grass, but it has got less nutritional content. Why am I promoting it if it has nutritional content? It's a body filler. It's a body filler. You chop in a small area,
okay,
and you fill your stomach on top of supplement. But it's good also for those people who are in a wetland, who are, you know, your land, you normally get a lot of water, and you want something that can be edible, then this is a grass.
Okay.
I want my dear farmers, to learn the difference between why you should plant the protein and carbohydrates. It's like you have a smaller land, smaller acreage of land. So instead of planting proteins, then here you go for, you mix them together. Mix the protein, this is glycine, and inside there is centrosema. This one is centrosema, but this is Choris guyana. So you mix them together, you plant them together, after planting them together, then you harvest. There you harvest both protein and carbohydrates. This hay is going to be one of the rich in protein and carbohydrates for animals. It's like you're serving both beef, matoke, and karo at once in human beings. In animals, you're serving both protein, these beans here, and carbohydrates. Even when you're going to sell, a bell that has these legumes and carbohydrates is going to be expensive compared to when you plant Choris only. That is number one. Number two, it's a cover crop. It's fixing nitrogen in the soil so that your soils are going to be enriched with fertile soils. Then, and again, the herbage is going to be a lot. Imagine the protein is so, the herbage is a lot. So when I'm going to get my hay, I slash everything. I slash everything, pack it, and sell it. Yes. Yeah, that's the thing now. That's the thing. So protein, so I'm encouraging most of the farmers to plant these things, both the silage, rather the hay, mixed with the beans, so that they can have the good protein supply at once. The good thing with this zero grazing, as I've seen, compared to that free range, I'm selling the manure. Remember, we started it saying a competitive advantage. Don't ever do a business where you don't have competitive advantage. We are in urban areas. People are looking for manure. Imagine if you're in free range. We're going to this manure. As you have seen outside, I'm having 100 bags of manure collected from this, from just only 6 cows. Each bag is 10,000. But probably by one of that is 1 m after 2.5, 3 months. Okay, so I'm selling this manure. That is advantage number one, which you're not going to get from free range, number one. Number two, how are you going to collect? Because you have seen our biogas. Biogas, the main component is the poop, the cow dung.
Yes.
For someone who is on free range, a cow poops here, then after a kilometer, after, where are you going to? So it's here to collect. It's easy to collect urine, it's easy to collect the cow dung, and use it. Use manure, use the what? For biogas. It's very easy. Someone who is on free range is not going to have that. Then, the comfortability of a farmer, the comfortable. You know, we don't want to take farmers as my grandfather in 1980s, 1998. We are in modernity, where we are seated. You know, have you ever seen this? I'm seated in a club. We are talking, I'm going to have my tea here. The comfortability, the ease of doing farming, because labor, where are you going to get all these workers? The rain, you're going to have most of the workers moving, going. But here, I normally have my workers, they're here up to 6 years, up to 7 years. Why? The comfortability, in a real language of yours, they call it swag. There is swag, swaggerific in this kind of environment. You sit, seated here, you look after your cows very well, the clean environment, the therapy, and you enjoy when you're doing, which is not in free range.
Okay.
Yes.
Finally, how does a man like you work closely with the woman? So I know that there are people that run businesses, and in most cases, the men take the lead, and the women never have any idea. So in case anything happens to the man, the business disappears.
Wow.
How do you handle yours?
I like that question. Really, we sat together with my wife after watching other people, family businesses. We saw Jessa doing as a family. We saw this St. Lawrence schools working as a family. I think family business is one of the best things farmers in Uganda are lacking. For example, here, in case I'm not around, my wife is going to be here. And we also taught our young kids. In case of anything, they're also going to be there. We are doing it as a family business. She's here, I'm there. Now, the advantage is in that you're employed here. Instead of scattering the resources, she has a shop in town, then you have, you know, but all the kamani, all whatever it is, collected here. You get your money here, you feed, you don't have any transport, that you're going to transport, you're going to transport to go to work and here. Mm. So we are looking everything, most of our things here. Number two, there is posterity. There is this kind of continuation.
Yes.
That in case there is somebody, maybe I'm sick, maybe I'm dead, maybe something.
Out of the country or something like that, yes.
Your wife is going to be there. In case she's not there, I'm here. Then also there is love. Mm. You know, take a sentence, whatever. Your wife is there. I'm here.
That's right.
We are working together, yeah. Mm. That's together. That's continuation love. What people, actually, you're laughing, but that's a very good point.
Yes.
Most of the people, you find the wife is working in Kabong or Abim. Mm. The man is working in Barara. They spend the whole month, the whole year, and they call it marriage. That's not marriage. Okay, that's not marriage. Marriage is when you're seated looking at your wife. Your wife is still looking at you. Mm. So that you look after your family, you look after your kids. What is lacking? That thing is lacking.
Yeah.
Most of the, we started this family between me and my wife. We take care of each other.
Okay.
We groom our kids very easy. We eat together. We love together. We bond together as love. So I could say one number one fan is love. There is love when you're working with your wife.
Okay.
We are looking forward, really, first of all, that in 3 years from now, we want to put accommodation. Many people, they are asking us, Businje, for us, many guys are calling us from Sudan, from Kenya, from where. They want to come, but where are we going to? So we want to put accommodation facility where people could come and sleep and enjoy milk and see the fruits. You have not seen our fish, then we are putting bees. So number one, we want to put accommodation here. Number two, we want to build a very big workshop house where people could come and get training, get advisory centers. Then number three, we want to do agro-tourism, where people could come. Because not everyone, by the way, is interested in your animals, in your people. There are some sons of the rich, daughters of the rich, who come and see cows.
Yeah.
They have never seen cows. They're in Kororo. They normally see cows on TV. We want this agro-tourism, where we can charge a fee. People come and see cows, they see goats, they eat fish, they relax. That's the new Uganda.
Okay.
So those are some of our projects. I think 3 to 10 years, we shall be there.
Thank you very much.
Hello. I'm called Jole Businje. I'm a co-partner here at Itungo Pastures. I'm very happy to work with my husband. We are enjoying working together at Itungo Pastures. First of all, the beauty about working together as a family, when one of you is sick, another one will always be there. You cannot like close the business. Then also, it gives you time. Not like where you're employed. When you're employed and maybe you have like a party, you may fail like to get that time to go and go to the party. But here you make sure one stays to run the business, then another one goes to the party. Then also, ladies, I would advise ladies especially, because they are men who usually come here complaining that their partners don't like what they are doing. Please, I would advise listeners there, as you find when like some ladies like to work together, or you find men when they are not like interested in what the other partner is doing, I would like to advise them, at least you get interested in what your partner is doing. Because when you're like employed somewhere and maybe, God forbid, you die, your job cannot like be inherited. But when it's a family business and one person is gone, another one will always take it to learn. Then also the kids, please parents, try to introduce the kids to the businesses that you're doing, so that when you start teaching them to run the businesses, especially like this farming we are doing, or it may even be like a hotel, it may be a tourism, any business, make sure you don't like do it alone. Introduce your family. Let your wife or your husband or your children or your partner be also introduced to the business, so that you can do it together.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, so in terms of finances, you know, it's one of the biggest things families have. I don't know how much my husband earns. Maybe he's spending money on women, you know, things like that. How does working with your husband feel, knowing what has come in and how you're spending the finances?
Oh, now the fortunate part of it here, I'm the accountant. So we give ourselves salaries. And so we sat together, I and my husband, and we agreed, of course, we get some certain percentage and we put it on like a family account on what we are supposed to do. And then also we leave allowances to ourselves, because I have my interests as a lady, for example, like I need to work on my hair, I need to paint my nails, and also my husband has got his interests. So we put some percentage where all of us, we put on like a family account, and then we leave a small percentage to do what he or me, I wish to do.
So there you have it. If you're settling down to start a business, it is important that you do market research. Conduct some market research, understand where your clients are. Also, it's important to know what kind of product is needed on the market. Like we keep saying, do not start a business simply because you have money. Start a business that offers services to society. What are those things that people need in society? And maybe that is where you should put your focus so that you'll be able to make that money. Look at the product. What is unique about your product over your competitors? All this, you need to pay attention to them so that you can make some money when you finally decide to move in. Now, let's talk personal finance tips for this weekend. So we've had people say, I'm so bright, I'll keep all my records in my head like a computer. Now, tell us about the need for records, and someone will tell you, well, you know what, records are simply things you write down to help you remember some of the things you did. This week on personal finance, Caroline from MoneyWiser tells us just how important it is for you to take down records, not just of the money you've spent, but generally of the things you do in your life. Take a look.
My name is Caroline Mary Amase, a certified financial literacy trainer. Thank you for watching The Business Show.
Talk to us about record keeping and how important it is generally in life and business as well.
Well, we need to understand first what a record is. Basically, a record is a summary of events and transactions in our day-to-day life. A record is something that informs you of your day-to-day transactions, for example, what you've spent money on, the business deals that you've had. There are so many forms of records that we deal with in our day-to-day lives. We have wills, we have receipts, we have land agreements, we have bank statements. These are things that we use daily, but sometimes we might not value that they can actually play a big role when it comes to certain eventualities in our lives. Now, most of us have heard about land wrangles, where you find that one person paid money, the other person paid money, and it is unfortunate that no one can justify it given the fact that there is nothing documented anywhere. Record keeping is important not only for employees or employers, but everyone. Employers, for example, can use the records that are kept in their premises for purposes of, for example, purposes of appraising their employees. Employees as well can also document specific aspects in their roles in jobs to justify their relevance in an institution. Even for small business owners, record keeping is very key, as it can enable them keep track of their clients, follow up with their clients, and possibly continue with the businesses with the same clients. Now, records are things that can enable you qualify even for opportunities as and when they arise. It is very key for everyone doing business to keep records for purposes of compliance. For example, it is so hard to tell a legislator that you didn't make profit, for example, in your business, if you don't have a record anywhere. So businesses, individuals, companies, everyone needs a record for purposes of projecting their future business lines, for purposes of understanding the level at which their businesses have reached, for purposes of compliance, for purposes of relationship with other bodies. We need to keep records. Now, many of us might wonder, how am I going to keep a record? There is no rocket science in any way in keeping records. There are so many solutions that even digital platforms have come up with to enable one keep a record. Surprisingly, most of these platforms are actually free of charge, and you can download those apps and utilize them. We can also keep our records in a traditional way, where you have your normal notebook and you note down every day your expenses, keeping in mind your income sources. Records are very important in our day-to-day life, in that it enables you, first of all, understand where your money has gone. That is keeping track of your expenses. It enables you also understand whether you're making profit or not. It enables you, especially if you have a business, it helps you not to mix up personal money and also business money. Most of the times you find directors of companies mixing up company money and individual money, which at the end of the day, they remain in a hanging position where they don't understand whether the business is performing well or not. So regardless of what transaction, what deal it is, just keep that record.
All right, interesting stuff there from Personal Finance Tips, and we hope you can start monitoring what you do by noting down records. Remember, we always say that when you do things and you don't realize that some of the things you've done were not planned for, then along the way, no one is going to help you account for the wrong decisions you've made. But if you take down records, then you keep ticking on what you've gotten right, you'll be able to know what has not worked. So in the future, you'll be able to ensure that you stay on track by keeping in check with your records. Let's take a look at the Forex and Money Markets report for this week. So to the downward trajectory, you realize the fuel prices continue to drop, and maybe it's just good for us as the business people, because almost everything that we do in business, there is a bit of fuel involved. So if these prices can keep going down, then maybe the whole cost will be switched slowly, and the final consumer can equally have something to smile at the end of the day as they go shopping. But for now, let's run you through the different prices across the pumps in the major cities in the country. So there's a lot that will be happening in October, of course, not just the Independence Day, but in terms of business, there's many conferences coming through, including the FinTech that will be looking at the milestones 5 years down the road. What are some of the things they're celebrating? Plus, the mega UMA trade fair, the IDEA trade fair that happens in the country every year. It will be happening from the 3rd to 10th of October this year. So I hear people say when they go to the trade fair, they don't make money. But the thing is, for a business person, if you make your way down to the trade fair, you're simply going to showcase. If you can sell something, then it's okay. But remember, a trade fair is a platform for you to, one, generate or make new clients, two, put out your products so people understand. So it's important that when you take some time off and go to these expos, ensure that you place your products in a way that will attract clients. Give out your cards. Stay in check with them. If they say, we'll get back to you, you get back to them. Don't wait for them to get back to you, because look, you need them more than they need you. So move out to them and let them know that you are still waiting for that promise, and see if they can take on some of the products. So we hope you do that. And remember also, like we keep saying on this show, everything you do in your business every other day should be only aiming to improve how the returns work out. My name is Simon. Feel free to get in touch, and we'll be more than glad to respond to your feedback. Until then, you take care of yourselves. Remember, the Business Clinic, Tuesdays, 7:30 on Rush Hour. Still with me. So make a date and learn one, two, three things about your business. You take care. We'll see you soon. Bye for now.